Okay, in this video I'm going to talk a little bit about backpropagation, which is probably one of the best known training methods for neural networks. Probably the majority of neural networks that are out there have been trained by backpropagation. And it was requested that I do a video on it. I wanted to do something fairly detailed at a later date, but for now I'm just going to give a quick overview on how to do it in Simbrain. And let me start by just giving you the basic idea behind backprop. The idea is that you're performing some kind of a pattern association task, right? Where you want to associate one set of vectors with another set. And so this is, let's say these are our input vectors here, and these are our target vectors here. All right. And we want to make a network that associates the two. So we want it so that there's four input neurons, and when you put in input 1000 into those input neurons, the result is 0001 on the output neurons. And similarly for these four patterns. All right, so it's sort of a kind of a binary vector reverser or something. So this is what we want, and when you make a backprop network, you need to start with this, with sort of a description of your training task. All right, now let's see how to build this in Simbrain. First, of course, you're going to make a network window. I press this new network button. And then you go to insert, insert network, and backprop. Usually you're going to want three layers. Occasionally you could do more. And if you want to make more, you just sort of, you could put in the number of layers you want and click change, and this dialog will change appropriately. But we'll stay with three. And then you want the appropriate number of input and output neurons. Layer one is input, layer three is output. And then some number of hidden neurons. And there are various algorithms for determining the correct number of input neurons. Sometimes it's useful to see, you know, how few you can get away with, sort of a compressed representation. Oftentimes you just want enough to finish, you know, get your task to work. Here I'll just leave it at the default of 5. All right. You could also specify the type of sigmoidal neuron used in the hidden and output layer. So it's a slightly more advanced topic. I'll leave this all at the defaults. All right. The most important thing here really are these two numbers, which need to match the sort of parameters of our training task. Okay, so there's our network. You could adjust it to look how you like. Notice four input neurons, four output neurons. So it's sort of the right form to compute this task. Now the main interface for training your network is here, this interaction box at the top, and you could right click on it and it gives you a few options, but really I usually just double click on it. All right, and this is kind of where all the action happens. This tab is where you specify your input data, which is this stuff. All right, and then this tab is where you're going to specify your target data. And the rows are, you know, it's sort of this is row one, and that corresponds to this row one. This row 2 corresponds to this row 2, and so forth. So I'm just going to manually enter these values. And we don't need this last one, so here I'm going to right-click and delete row. All right, so I'll do the same thing here. I will note that editing these cells is a little bit wonky right now. This is sort of a known issue, although I haven't opened a GitHub issue on it yet. Okay, delete that row. So we're all set. We've got our task set up, and now it just remains to train the network. And what we want to do here is get the error as close to zero as possible. All right, and what the error is basically saying is how far on average is the actual output this network produces. And let's just randomize here. This randomizes the weights, as you could see, and the biases. And if you start off with random weights, of course, you know, initially it's going to just get everything wrong. And so, you know, you put in 1000 and it's going to do some other thing that's going to be some distance away from this target value. And so roughly speaking, the error is how far away on average the actual outputs are from the target outputs. Now I'm saying this all in a very rough intuitive way. I refer you to other sources for details on how these numbers are computed. All right, so to iterate this, this should train pretty fast, so I'm just gonna iterate with this button here. And you could see the error is going down. This is using a method called gradient descent fairly quickly, and you can see it looks like it's going to get maybe all the way to zero. I'm just going to press play here. All right, and pretty soon it gets to zero. This time series shows the change in error over time. This is not working properly right now, so just kind of a warning. And this is what you use to randomize the weights and biases if you want to start over. Sometimes the error doesn't go very low, and so you just sort of try again. You click here to let's just do that. I'll randomize and start again. You can see there's a bump in there was a little bump in the error, and it quickly went back down to zero. This is a pretty easy task for the network to learn. But if you do anything with real-world data, anything more complicated, you probably won't get zero error here, and it'll take a few tries to sort of get it as low as you can. There's a few parameters here. There's a learning rate and a momentum parameter, which I won't get into. In a lot of cases, it helps to adjust these. And I will also point out that the implementation of Backprop in Simbrain right now is very bare bones. This is an area we really want to improve in coming iterations of Simbrain. It's an area where you, the open source community, could really help by contributing. So there's more to come. But certainly the sort of bare bones Backprop we have now is enough to do simple tasks like this one. Okay, so we've trained the network now. It's at zero. And so it should now implement this task. So to test it, double-click here again and go to the Validate Input Data tab. And if you click this, it just goes through the different rows of the input data. All right, and you can see it's doing what we wanted. So the 1000 is going to 0001, 0100 is going to 0010, and we're kind of getting this reversal thing we trained it on. All right. Okay, let me also point out a gotcha here, something to be aware of. The input nodes are clamped to make it easy to sort of play with it and test it. So for example here, if I clear that node and I make this one go to 1 and just iterate, I see that I get the desired result. I could also see if I gave it something slightly different like this, what we get. And it actually, even though this isn't what we trained it on, it still kind of gets what we'd expect. Okay, so there is one gotcha here. These neurons are clamped to make it easy to do the kind of tests I was just showing you, right? Again, I could put something in, double-click, and make sure I get the right thing out. Or I could put in, you know, other values and just see what it comes up with. All right, so that's kind of interesting. It wasn't trained on this, so, you know, sometimes it's interesting to ask how well a network generalizes to things it wasn't trained on. So this is good for sort of quick testing. But because these nodes are clamped, if you send in activation from somewhere else, say, let's say this neuron, or if you sort of create, like you might create a data table and feed that into here, if you do that, you'll get unexpected results at first. So for example here, and let me clamp this neuron. So I double click and go to clamped, yes. All right. If I iterate, you can see nothing happens, and that's because this is clamped. And if I want to unclamp it so that I could hook other things up to this input layer, I could double click here on the input layer tab and go here to more and unclamp here. Click no and click apply. All right, and now this should register properly.